Director of Research and Evaluation and Clinical Supervisor at Chain Incorporated. He earned a Bachelor's in Business Administration at a local state college and a Master of Arts and Doctorate in Marriage and Family Therapy from Argosy University, Twin Cities. John has employed the Relational Diagnostic Assessment in various clinical settings for 7 years and has been involved in its development and training for the past 3 years. And then just a reminder, make sure cell phones are off, we're on vibrate.
Which is a good thing, and it has its drawbacks. One of the drawbacks would be that we have an hour and 45 minutes, and part of what I like to do with this material is to create dialogue, and I try to make it as experiential as possible when I can. So just be prepared for that, since it's an intimate group. I don't know what the presentations have been like for you so far, but I know when I go to presentations, I get that part of this. I don't want to interact with people that are here. I just want to sit here and write, get the information. That's probably, you're not going to get out of here without interacting with each other, my forecast. So if you have any thoughts about that, you can turn to your table partners, share those thoughts, and then from there. Correction to what might be on there is that on the outline for this, Dave Hesse was originally going to join me. He could not make it today, unfortunately. Which means I'll be covering his part, which I don't have the material for, so I'm just going to make it up as I go. That's all I have to say about that. First of all, this is the last one of the day, right? This is the last session of the day. Mm-hmm. So how's it going so far?
Good.
Yeah. Learning lots. Good. So what I appreciate you saying learning lots, because I don't want this to be a thing where I'm teaching you anything per se. This is more sharing with you work that we're doing and an approach that we use at Change Inc. in Minneapolis. And it's up for you to consider whether or not you're interested in learning more about it. So I don't want this to become a lecture per se, although I do tend to lecture, so hopefully somebody will say, John, you're lecturing a little bit. What I'd like to do first is I'm going to give you, I'll probably be preaching to the choir a little bit here, is my guess, but just in case, just to kind of get us all on the same page. So Minnesota, beautiful Minnesota, excellent. Excellent in terms of educational achievement. So we have some of the highest scoring students in the country. Yay, Minnesota. However, the scores of students, particularly in underprivileged, underserved communities, like where we have a lot of, we provide a lot of services at Change Inc. In North Minneapolis and South Minneapolis, the scores are really in the toilet. They're some of the lowest in the country, actually. And they're really low when you look at national averages. So, some people have said that this is an achievement gap. But we at Change Inc., while we pay alternative programs, we take call, we actually think that that's not true. We think of it more as an opportunity or an accessibility gap. That there are issues related to the lack of cultural responsiveness, a lack of contextual relevance, and a lack of relational competence that might be driving some of these achievement gaps, or what we're going to call opportunity and existence gaps. And if we can create these things here in our schools with the kids we're working with, that we can actually we can improve some of this. Anybody have any thoughts on that? Then there's also this research practice gap in what some have called the current era of accountability in mental health. Who are you, by the way, mental health providers? Okay. What are your areas of focus? Licensure? Are you licensed?
Almost.
Almost? License? Yeah. Jenna, your license?
I am.
What's your license?
I'm a licensed graduate social worker.
Oh, excellent. Okay.
Hello, welcome, good morning.
What else do we have? What other disciplines are represented here?
Clinical mental health.
What is it?
Counseling, clinical mental health counseling.
Excellent, okay. Both same, okay. And what's your focus?
I teach that we don't care and we don't have any treatment.
And then other folks, what are your, oh, did you say that you were mental health?
Yeah, I'm an LSCSW.
LSCSW, okay. Which I affectionately refer to as the Lishy Swish. And you too?
I'm a teacher.
You're a teacher, okay. What do you teach?
I teach at MSUM for students in special ed. So it's more head, yes.
Yeah, more head state. Then I don't mean to obscure this lovely person over here. And your, what's your background?
Marriage and family therapy.
Excellent. And I say lovely person because this is actually my colleague and my wife.
And videographer.
And I may be drawing on her because she has clinical knowledge and awareness of this model that I'm going to show you today. Okay, so that gives me a sense of who's in the room. I appreciate that. So for those of us that are in the field practicing mental health, you've probably been at some point heard of something called empirically supported treatments, evidence-based practices. And in our current era of accountability, I'm not going to bore you with the details, I'm just going to give you the highlights to sort of provide some impetus for this work here, why this is important to us. So empirically supported treatments, there was a review that looked at 160 of the reviews that reviewed empirically supported treatments that made them qualify as ESD. And of those, they found that only 22.5% of those treatments actually showed a positive effect. Meaning those that qualified to become an empirically supported treatment, of all of those, really only 22.5% showed that they had any sort of positive effect, which is kind of surprising. You'd think it'd be a bit more robust if it qualifies as an ESD. This is a pretty rigorous research protocol to go through, right? What's even more surprising is that 41.3% showed insufficient or no effect. So, altogether, you can say that really, the ESTs, they're really not satisfying their own rigorous research criteria. In other words, it might be time to start looking at something else. And then, of course, who here loves paperwork?
Oh,
great. Awesome. Yeah. Does anyone here do CASIs?
Yes,
too. SDQs? Yeah. What paperwork do the rest of you do that you just love?
We have internal, during the child and adolescent behavioral focus.
And are those,
hand wrapping and
are those documents that you've generated in your agency?
No. Start with me, and then go to the graph that show me here. Relationship.
really touch it again until I have to. So what we're offering here is maybe something that may seem cumbersome at first, what I'm going to show you today, the RDA, the Relational Diagnostic Assessment, but it's only because it's one of our primary functions is training, and I'll get to that in a second. But I just wanted to get a sense of who likes the paperwork here. It sounds like you all love the paperwork, so just some other facts quickly. Of the clients in our care, it's estimated that about 50% of our clients actually drop out. And this is based on outpatient stats. So I'm sure that if we had school-based stats, it would be probably higher. That is to say, those clients that you get referred to, or that get referred to you, that actually become clients, it's probably not very, well, it depends on the clinician. But overall, we know that 50% of our clients drop out of therapy, and that actually 10-15% of the clients actually get worse from our care. And then there's the DSM. Now, my colleague told me not to berate or belittle the DSM too much, so I'm going to try hard not to. I'm just going to say that I think the DSM, while attempting to be empirically based using a biomedical disease model, is probably not very valid when it comes to our school-based mental health stuff. I know it's certainly not valid, or I'll say it's problematic when working with culturally diverse communities. And that's all I'm going to say about the DSM. That's not bad, right? Okay. I'll just say the DSM is problematic. And that last point, within in the culturally diverse communities, the DSM is problematic, leads me to the question of cultural competence. And I say the question mark because the buzz had for, you know, 10, 15 years has been this cultural competence thing, and I don't know what that means. What culture would that be? So when somebody asks if you're culturally competent, what culture would that be? My culture? What is my culture? Are you talking about your client's culture? If they're African American? If they're Hispanic? Does that mean that there's a general thing that we do for Hispanic or African American cultures that we can be competent in? I mean, I think the term is problematic because it tends to do the thing that we're trying to not do, which is it kind of generalizes. So some folks have offered that another way to consider cultural competence is really to think of it as, do you know the specific symbols of that cultural community? Do you know what they mean? And do you know, or would the people in that cultural community recognize you as competent in that particular culture? So for example, I work with a guy named Corey Bird who's in charge of our Welcome to Key program. And just the other day, he said to me, hey John, here you're moving. By the way, we're moving to Hawaii in the school year in June. So he said, John, do you know any of the cultural symbols in Hawaii? I said, yeah, man, shaka, you know, hang loose. He said, oh, you know, if we were at school right now, you'd get kicked out of school for doing that. Because it'd be a gang sign. I said, gang sign? Let's hang loose. You know, it's part of the Hawaiian culture. And he said, no, here in Minnesota, in Minneapolis, that's a gang sign. I don't care what culture it's from, it's a gang sign, so you can kick out. So there's an example of a symbol, a specific cultural symbol that has different meanings in different cultural contexts. So what we're going to do here today is we're going to talk about the relational foundations of this relational diagnostic assessment. First of all, how are we going to overall? Okay, we're going to start with that. There are three things we're going to do here. This is part one, relational foundation, where I'm going to tell you a story. I don't know if it's going to be a very good story, but I'm going to tell the story anyway. So my introduction to, well, I'm going to tell you about the RDA. So the RDA started with this gentleman here, Dr. James Nelson. He lives in Minneapolis. He is an ordained Baptist, Southern Baptist minister. He's got a doctorate in divinity. He went to school later on at the U of M, family social science, PhD, and He started his work in Minneapolis. He's from Missouri originally. So he's kind of this hazy, yucca yucca kind of guy. And that's what he would say, not me. He started by he came up here from Missouri and worked in the South High School in Minneapolis. And he started working with adolescents. And as he was working with them, he said that he had this sense of, he always wondered what relationships were affecting the folks, these kids that he was working with. And one day he said he was working with this kid who said, the kid said, last night my dad chased my mom around the house with a baseball bat and she had to lock herself in the bedroom. And Jim said, you know, he was pissed. He had never heard of that before. He was trying to imagine himself in that situation and he couldn't imagine it. And then this kid said, if the fucker does it again, I'm going to kill him. And Jim thought, well, that's a pretty good idea, actually. Sounds about right. But Jim somehow pulled together and started to think about, okay, what would be best here? And he decided he should meet the parents. And this is in the 70s, mind you. So this is kind of before, you know, we're doing this whole marriage and family therapy thing, or at least it wasn't quite mainstream yet. And so he met the parents, and he said he was struck by how reasonable they were. And it occurred to him that they were just, they were loving people. They were actually good people who were doing the best they could. And it really changed the way he believed. It opened his eyes to the fact that his relationship really influenced the way people behave. So, fast forward 20 years, he meets Jody Nelson. Yes, they're married. And he and Jody, Jody, by the way, let's see, what's her background? She's got, she's an English teacher, was an English teacher for a long time, got an English degree from, I think, Nebraska State University. She then got an educational doctorate from the University of St. Thomas, and she's been a principal, and now she's an assistant director over at Guadalupe Alternative Programs. She is, she's a pretty amazing woman. She's got extremely clear thinking, and she's a bulldog. I mean, she will, if you mess with Jody, she will mess you up. So this dynamic duo here, after now 30 plus years of working together, have come to know some things about what can be helpful in school-based mental health clinics, particularly working with adolescents and their families, particularly working in inner city, underserved, underprivileged communities. So my introduction to those two came when I started in graduate school, and Jody was my my prof, group professor. Jim was a professor of mine. They kind of inducted me into the relational thing that we're going to talk about today, that we're talking about right now. And I joined the changing cult, and we're hoping to conscript you all to conspire and become part of the changing cult too, perhaps. But the flagship product or site for the Relational Diagnostic Assessment has been Edison High School in Northeast Minneapolis. Anyone here familiar with Edison High School? Heard of it? And it's one of the most culturally diverse schools in Minneapolis. It's got about 900 students. I think there are 30 different languages spoken in the homes of the students that go there. Lots of diversity in terms of race and ethnicities in this school. And in fact, Deepa was there. You were there early on, back in 2008?
Six.
Oh, so you were there the first year that it started. So back in 2006, Jim and Jody got together, and through the their ability to form relationships, were able to get some money to start a school-based mental health site in Edison High School. And what they did when they first entered was they took this relational diagnostic assessment, and they actually did a relational climate assessment, meaning that they looked at the entire school. They looked at the school as their client, basically. And they went in and they looked at what relationships were working, what were the challenges in the school's ability, their mission to educate students, what did the school attempt to do to correct those challenges? challenges and what did they want was the gist of the relational planning assessment. And then they took all those answers and they did some content analysis and they gave it back to the school. And the school said, hey, we like this. Let's go ahead and let's have you come in and do some mental health with us. So nearly 10 years later, what you have now is you have this community school collaborative. And this community school collaborative consists of 11 school-based sites, and we provide mental health services, we provide our Welcome and Key program, and we're a huge workforce development program, meaning that we take in interns and externs, and we train them on the relational diagnostic assessment, and then we send them out to the world, hopefully to infect the rest of the world. Hopefully we'll turn the rest of the world into our cult followers, our acolytes, in the next thing.
Hello, welcome. Come on down.
That is, let's see. So there's Jim. That's Corey Bird. He's the director of our Welcome to Key program, which is basically our prevention and early intervention program. He works with the high flyers. These are the kids that the school would say, these guys are even at most risk for being suspended or kicked out. Sam Gurno, he's a day with Medicine Man, Ojibwa affiliation, and he does some school-based supervision for us. Lisa Jean, she is the site lead at Hmong International Academy in North Minneapolis. That's Keith Ellison, he's a senator. It's Corey Yeager. He is a former director of operations at Changing. There's Jennifer Romji. She is our kind of our director of the, I think she's the director of the North Minneapolis schools. Could be wrong. It's a new role for her, but she's definitely the site lead at Edison. Dave Hesse, he was supposed to join us today. He wasn't able to. Dick Mammon, he's on the Minneapolis Public School Board. And then Heidi Schlewitz is our director of administration. So this team, plus others that aren't up here, have been the driving force behind what you're going to get today. All right. Welcome. And what's, who are you?
Catherine Grasha.
Catherine, it's nice to meet you.
Thank you. Nice to meet you.
Psychologist Frazier. Excellent. Thank you. That's exactly what I wanted to know. Your background was. Okay. Now we have a psychologist in them, so I have to be extra careful. No. I hope that what we're going to offer isn't offensive to anyone, and if it is, I apologize. So now we can talk about some contextualizing theories. So we have our common factors approach for working with school-based mental health sites, and it starts with curiosity. Now I know it kind of seems like, you know what, that's pretty vanilla, John. Yeah, it is. It's foundational, though. And it involves starting a conversation with somebody. It involves confessing to somebody. Having a student tell you a story about something. You telling a student or a student's parent a story about something that you're experiencing with them. For example, when Jim had that experience with that family, he was able to share his experience with his own emotional reaction with that family in a way that was useful, that bonded them. And in that way, he does or did what Zora Hurst, author of Their Eyes Were Watching God, anthropologist. And she wrote that you gotta go there to know them. And so that's what Jim did by allowing himself to go into that family's culture, into their story, and then sharing with them what his experience was. He was going there. And he did what Dr. Naeem Akbar says you gotta do when you go into new cultures. You gotta earn the right to be heard. So you gotta hear their story first. You got to earn the right to be curious. So you got to go in there with humility and say, I really don't know, and I'd like to be curious. And if I have information, I'll be curious about experience. Which leads to our second common factor, which is awareness of self and awareness of others. So, in an interview, Deepak Chopra was asked to define spirituality. He said, spirituality is increasing your awareness of yourself and increasing your awareness of other people. We agree. So part of our common factors would be doing that. And in that process, as you're being curious, as you're increasing your awareness of self and other, you're identifying relational patterns that are informing whatever your client's there for. Now, this is a domain of just about every clinical theory you can think of. They all are identifying some kind of pattern. I have a bias towards family therapy, social science theories, but you can choose psychology, social sciences, whatever you want. Any clinical theory is going to basically be looking for patterns. We then put these patterns into our what we call the problem-solving solution formation, solution-focused formation process, which is we're curious how people's problems are attempting to be solved and how they're forming solutions as well. And this is kind of borrowing from off of some family therapy theories, strategic family therapy that looked at problem formation and attempted solutions as kind of being the thing that's maintaining presenting issues. And then we're also drawing from the postmodernist solution-focused therapy. It says that, try to imagine a future without your problems, looking for exceptions, basically. And that leads to the final one, which is creating contrast. And this is drawing from, like I said, postmodern theories. But actually, it was Gregory Bateson who said, all humans learn only when there is a contrasting circumstance to their current circumstance. So we only learn through contrast. We only become aware of something once we're aware of the difference between something else. So for example, if I brush this table here, you're not aware of the difference that's occurring at the molecular level because we can't see it. But if I did this long enough, or I did this with a hard tool of some sort, and I created a gouge in this table, then you become aware. So similarly, when we're working with clients, oftentimes in anthropology, what they do when they go into new cultures is they look for polarities. They look for examples of times when whatever it is that they're seeing isn't happening. So with our clients, we want to know, what are the exceptions to your presenting problems? What are the times that you're not having this issue? Those are our common factors. There are, of course, the common factors of psychotherapy and family therapy, which we subscribe to as well, but just wanted to present our common factors. Okay. Our next perspective is an ecological one. So we see people as being embedded and influenced by, embedded within relationships and influenced by those relationships. But we modify this a little bit. So we've taken from Yuri Bronfenbrenner's ecological perspective, and we modify it a little bit, just in the three concentric circles. So we start off with the intrapersonal. This would be the domain of, say, psychology. Or if you're doing family therapy, you might do internal family systems. We want to know what's the self-talk going on? What are the parts that are talking interpersonally? How are they making decisions? What are those internal narratives they have going on? The next domain would be the interpersonal. This would be the domain of the family social science theories or traditional family therapy models. What are the alliances? What are the coalitions? What are subsystems, dyads, triads, etc.? And then finally, the social cultural. What are the beliefs surrounding? And this I would offer is a combination of the intra and the inter, because it could be what are the beliefs of the culture that the client's living in that are forming their self-talk or their narratives. Artifacts might be a DSM diagnosis. Now, what is a kid is diagnosed as depressed? What does depressed mean to that kid? Or depression as a cultural artifact? We have an idea of what depressed means, but what does it mean for that kid? And exploring the influence on those other ecologies for that kid. you put those all together and you get our ecological perspective, which is a huge part of this model. The next theory we draw on is symbolic interactionism. If you're all familiar with this, it's basically how do people make meaning out of their lives. And so, talking about symbols again, for example, if I have a kid who's depressed, who comes in and says, yeah, I'm depressed, I want to know, well, how did you come familiar with depressed? And in that way, I want to unpack those stories or experiences that led that kid to believe that he has or is experiencing this cultural artifact, this cultural symbol of depressed. What are the experiences, what are the stories, what are the relationships that inform that symbol? And so the kid says, well, I came down one day, and my mom said, honey, you look really depressed. And so then I said, okay, I guess that's what depressed is. Now, what we would offer is that we think such cultural artifacts obscure a lot of the normal developmental phases, particularly with adolescents, but I would say with younger folks too, I'd say with all human beings. We don't know what the norm would be for any particular emotional experience. I don't think we know it well enough to be able to say that, yeah, in fact, depression exists. So we're trying to contextualize it a bit by saying there's a meaning-making that goes on there. And what's going to be useful for our client, that kid who says I'm depressed, is to get to those rich stories, to thicken up that narrative, so that we can start to identify those relational patterns that are forming this kid's belief that he's depressed. Questions so far? And then finally, the developmental perspective. So here's an example of a worksheet that we use when we sit down with the kid. We've got the three circles here, the ecological perspective. And we're looking at intrapersonal patterns. What's the self-talk? What's the attribution processes? What are the narratives going on in this kid's head? We're looking at the interpersonal, so relationships within people, between people rather. Using that symbolic interaction as a meaning-making process. Tell me about the relationship with your mom or your dad. Tell me the first time that they said you were depressed and how did that affect you. And then we're looking at the social culture. Here in the social cultural, though, we believe that there are, in all cultures, developmental expectations placed on people. And that what we have come to know as developmental norms in this particular culture, I'm not sure by all cultures. For example, there was a Lakota woman who shared with us once that in her community, there are only four developmental stages. You start off in infancy, you move to child, you move to adult, and then you move to elder. And that's it. There's no adolescence. In fact, she offered that adolescence is only it only exists in our culture because the adults and the elders have failed to take responsibility for teaching our children how to move into the adult phases. Whether or not that might be true, I'm not here to argue that. I'm here to just offer that there are different developmental expectations for different cultures. And that when we're working with the intra and social cultural, we need to be mindful of those developmental expectations that might be in this student's mind. Because within those expectations, there are dilemmas of distress. And now we offer, from our perspective, based on our experience, that most of the students we work with are experiencing these dilemmas of distress that we often categorize using the DSM label as being some sort of a disorder, or pathologizing, basically, using a biomedical disease model. Now, we're offering that that's probably not very helpful. And at best, it's problematic, particularly in culturally diverse communities. So going back to those polarities, or looking for the exceptions, we want to know, what are the exceptions to these dilemmas of distress? I offered a high-level overview of the contextualizing theories. I'd like now to go into the creating of a culture. That's incorrect. It should be creating a culture, not creating a culture. So when I first started working at Edison, working with Shane Kang, Sam Gernow, the guy I showed you in that earlier slide, the day we met Edison, he said, "So John, why do you want to come work at Edison? Why do you want to come to Shane Kang?" And I said, "Well, I think I can be helpful." He said, "Well, who invited you?" And he gave me an ass whooping. I mean, not literally, but figuratively. He broke me down. He said, "We don't want you. What are you going to offer to us? We don't need you here." And I thought about that. It's, it really hurt. I felt belittled. I felt small. I felt insignificant. I felt misunderstood. And I shared that with him. I said, "This really hurts. I feel like an outsider now. I thought I was part of this family, and you just now made me feel like an outsider." He said, "Well, welcome to our experience, John." And then I got it. Thank you. That was the lesson. And I was grateful that you took the time to share that, to put me through that. And it wasn't just a one-day sort of thing. It was an ongoing experience. And everyone that you saw in that picture up there has put me through those kinds of trials and tribulations to one extent or another. And that's what I've come to realize is necessary at times in order for us, and I'm saying us because I'm not seeing a whole lot of diversity in this room as far as race is concerned. But we've got to be aware that we have some inherent privilege going into these communities. And I'm not talking about the social cultural class stuff that you went through where we're talking about white shame and I want you to feel like crap about yourself and the fact that you have an education and whatnot. Because I don't think that's very helpful. I'm talking about just realizing there's stuff that you're unaware of that's part of your cultural makeup because of how you were raised. It doesn't mean it's a bad thing. It's just a thing. But if you're going into a community that you're unaware of, if you don't live in the community, for example, like I live about four blocks that way. I live in this community. I work in this school right here, in this Edison High School. So I have a sense of, I'm part of this community. I can go in here with some sense that I know what's going on in this area. But even then, when I walk through these doors, I'm not a high school student. I don't know what it's like to go to high school here. So it goes back to those common factors of always remaining curious, always being aware that I don't know. And I think that's what we want to emphasize here. That's what I want to emphasize. We got to enter relationally. We got to enter with curiosity. And that's how you start to create a shared culture, is when you enter in that way. So what I'd like to do here, I'm going to ask you two or four questions. So given what I just said, it kind of presents a dilemma. Because if I'm promoting here this not knowing stance, how do you know if you're any good as a therapist? What do you think? How can you not know and then say that you're any good as a therapist? I mean, it's kind of a paradox, isn't it? Don't know, but then you better know. That's true. Yeah, that's good.
Use their cues.
Use their cues. What would some of their cues be?
I mean, if they show up in your office, you know, if they open up to you, if they trust you, if they seek you out, if they, you know, help you with your needs, let you into their world, tell you their stories.
Yeah. That's good.
That's nice. Put a lot on the one here. That house that I told you about that I have. I have a Bulgarian, a Latino, a Chinese, a Somalian, a Western Indian, and a Native American, and we're all girls. And I'm a Swedish cook. One girl loves animals, one, it's taboo to be touched or to play an animal. One girl, right, is very safe. cases are special and they're handled as this is what makes me, and then I find the curiosity piece coming back because now the other girls are curious. Tell me more. I want to hear more. What do you do with this? One culture girls are not valued in, and yet they study 6 hours a day. And another culture is that they're coming out at 16 and they have children at 16. Well, the other girls are getting the message legally. But their cultures are so different in all of their world.
So how do you know you're any good as a therapist or your capacity?
I just have to do it. I have to listen more than I talk. I have to. I watch. I watch them work with each other, and I have to give them a lot of space, non-judgmental space.
So you know if you're doing those things, that you're doing a good job.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. Anything else? How do you know?
I think part of it is maybe starting with the question of what is it you're trying to accomplish and who is setting the goal. In other words, whose goals are the ones that are given priority, and then sometimes it's a matter of simply asking, is this working for you? Are things getting better?
That's excellent. So when you're putting the client in the center of the entire experience, that you know you're doing a good job. Yeah, I agree with that. Well, then how do you show that to others?
Well, tell them.
What's that?
I got a question. How do you show what to others?
Well, how do you demonstrate you're good as a therapist to others?
Like to your coworkers?
Others. That could be coworkers, sure.
Very difficult.
Good answer.
Showing people how I am. Like,
it's
follow me all day. I don't really know.
It is.
Because it's very hard to explain. I think sometimes when you're just in it with people, it's very hard action to explain in words. When you're just being with somebody, that's what I was. I'm just with them in their moment and their where they're at. And I'm like, well, how do you do that? I'm like,
Do it.
Exactly. Just go, and I don't have any expectations. I don't think I'm the expert.
Right.
I know on their family or their experiences, I'm an expert in other capacities, but I don't come in knowing that way. So I think it's just meeting them where they're at, where it is.
Yeah.
But it's a very hard thing to put into words.
It is very difficult. And even more difficult to actually show someone else that this is how I know I'm doing a good job as a therapist. Because it kind of creates, there's a bit of a culture clash, because we've started this talk about, be relational, be curious. All these very human, we'll call it humanology-based ideas. Humanology, again, drawing from Naeem Akbar. He said in a conference once that we have lost our minds to technology. Cost of our humanology. And humanology being defined as some of the things that we've known since we first existed on this planet, which would be how you make friends, how do you maintain relationships, how do you share with other people, and how do you forgive people, how do you acknowledge and grieve losses. How do you generate hope? These would all fall under the aegis of humanology. And those things are very difficult to show to someone else unless they're in there experiencing it with you. Yeah, that's right. It's hard. It's very hard. So what we're going to offer is, I think, it's one way of maybe showing to others and how to maintain that sense of how you know you're doing a good job as a therapist. And it starts with a simple formula. RC plus CK equals CR. This is about as formulaic as we're going to get. This is not algebra, by the way. What this is relational competence. So we're not rejecting cultural competence. We're simply saying we don't think that that's the end all be all of what we're doing here. it's problematic. So we're going to focus on relational competence because I think that's what folks are talking about when they're talking about cultural competence. They're really saying, can you enter into a culture that you don't know and develop some relationships, which then allows you to develop some cultural knowledge. So if you enter relationally, you're good at relationships, then you're more likely to get some cultural knowledge. And when you pair those things together, what you get is you get some cultural responsiveness. And that's what I think we're really trying to do here. And that way, we're transcending the idea of a specific cultural competence. And we're saying we can be responsive to our individual client's culture, whatever that might be, regardless of their race, their ethnicity, their gender. We can focus on what are their cultural norms. So, this is how we have, using all the earlier stuff that I've talked about, that I've shared with you, this is how we've operationalized all of these things into a way that we think, a model that allows us to know we're doing good jobs as therapists and then to demonstrate that to others. And it's through this relational diagnostic assessment. And it begins with the problem-solving solution-focused process, which leads to the ecological assessment. And we use the client perception form to demonstrate our worth as a therapist to others. We also use something called the session rating scale, which is not part of the RDA. I just want to be clear about that. It's actually developed by Duncan and Miller, the Talking Cures folks. And you can get that stuff online. Probably type in Scott Miller or Mary Duncan or Talking Cures. They're the common factor components. And they've got some really good stuff out there available for free. Scott Miller said I could use this, so so this is the RDA, and what we propose is, instead of doing the evidence-based practice thing, we're going to flip this sucker on its head. We're going to do practice-based evidence instead, because that allows us to lead with our practice and the client and the cultural responses that people do, rather than trying to impose a cultural worldview onto our clients. So what we do is we start with the client's perceptions. And we gather those perceptions using the problem-solving solution-focused process, the client perception form, the session rating scale, and our treatment plan. And then through employing some of those ethnographic concepts I was talking about earlier, with looking for polarities, exceptions, going with that curiosity, looking for those relational patterns. We put all that stuff into our ecograms, which I'm going to show you in a minute, and we reflect on these other components of the RDA. So we're looking at what are the patterns using the ecogram, those three concentric circles I showed you. We apply the perception form, which I'll show you in a minute. We look at the data on that and say, well, how are things going? Are they getting better? Are they staying the same? Are they getting worse? And that process employs the minimally scientific practice of the single system design, which I'm not going to get too much into today, even though I'm the director of research and evaluation. I don't want to bore you with that stuff, because I don't think it's going to be very helpful for you to become researchers. It's going to be helpful for you to learn to evaluate your practice stuff. So I'm not asking you to consider research, I'm asking you to consider practice evaluation. Questions about that? Diagnostic and statistical manual is problematic because it doesn't have any diagnostic value. It it doesn't create a diagnosis, tells you the cause of an issue and what treatment might be for it. The DSM does not do that. Does neither of those two functions. And nor are there any real statistical things in there, any value of these. So we're offering that our diagnostic assessment does offer some ideas about what might be creating or maintaining problems, such as relational patterns in those three ecologies, as well as ways that you might treat those, including leading with curiosity, identifying relational patterns, raising awareness of self and other, creating